for this afternoon session, we will have Will Williams from our Ontario, California branch.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
Well, with opening statements like that, I can't wait for the close time. I'm really glad to be here today. I didn't think I was going to make it here to Lansing, and for a lot of reasons, but God, we made a way, and I appreciate that. I have a subject I'd like to get into today. It's called The Times of the Gentiles. But before I can get into that subject, I have to preface it. Precursors, preliminaries, and predicates. So I'd like to start off with Isaiah 8:20.
Isaiah 8:20. Thus says
the Lord, to the law and to the testimony. Now, to the law and to the testimony.
Read. If they speak not according to this word.
Now, they speak not according to this word. Now, they who? Anybody. If they speak not according to this word, read.
It is because there is no light in them.
It's because they have no light or no understanding in them. Okay? Now, that's just a rule, okay? In fact, I like to even reduce it to a mathematical equation. Because Yahshua Messiah said that he came to fulfill. I didn't come here to set an example for you to follow. I came to fulfill the law and the prophets. Okay? Now, just from a mathematical point of view, you can look at it like this. There. Now. Okay. I think everybody's familiar with that. 1 + 2 = 3. You have an add-in, 2 add-ins, it equals up to a sum. But suppose that was missing. How would I find out the missing part? Well, I take that which is known to deduce that which is unknown. Okay? Likewise, it is with the scriptures. Law plus prophecy equals fulfillment. But suppose something is not apparent. What's hidden? Take that which is known. Fulfillment, the law, and I can find out that which is hidden or unknown. Now that's just very simple to do. And that's what Yahweh has done for us. By laying out witnesses and things like that, so that we can look at to understand this purpose as it's coming down through the ages and dispensations. Now, I'd like to go back, let's see, one more thing, and then I'll get to the scripture lesson. Romans 1, 19 and 20. Alright? Because I wonder, I did say I have to come up with some precursors, Romans.
This is Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. For Yahweh has shown it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power or supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So now, it takes the natural things. In other words, we look at the natural things around us to understand the invisible things or the things of the Spirit, because they are a reflection of that. Yahweh, who is pure spirit, see, he is the sum total, he's the source and the substance of everything. See, he is wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, power, foundation, strength. Now, Yahweh, pure spirit, in part, transmuted into this state, this shape and form, what we call a superincorporeal, or really, we call it this, we call this the great heavenly anthropomorphic being. That's just simply says this is a flesh, this is a spirit man call anthropomorphism. That's a nice fancy word. It just simply means to take on the shape and form of a man.
Right.
And this is the first cause of all creation. This is the creation.
Yeah.
Because when Yahweh took on shape and form or transmuted into the state, Yahweh, pure spirit, went into his rest. Mm-hmm. And it was the Son that did the work.
Right.
See? In other words, this was represented here. See, this and this heart right here we have here, this is spirit law. See, and the creation is drawn out of spirit law. See why? Because we have the first five books of our Bible, which is the books of the law, Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, and the testimony or the prophecy of the books from Joshua to Malachi. They are drawn out of the law. In other words, anything Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Zechariah, whatever they got to say, it's got to be found in the law, because that's what it's drawn out of. In other words, see, this creation is drawn out of the law, so this creation is a testimony of spirit law. Okay? Now, the scripture lesson. Matthew 24, I think maybe around 14, and why are you getting that? I want Matthew 24, 14, and I think I want Mark. Well, see, these are the corollary scriptures, because Mark, I think it's 11. No, Mark 13, 14. And I want Luke 21, 20. I want Matthew first.
This is Matthew 24, 14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world
mm-hmm.
for a witness unto all nations, mm-hmm. and then shall the end come.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Keep going. On Matthew.
15, 30.
Mm-hmm.
When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet.
Now this is the abomination of desolation that was spoken by Daniel the prophet. See, what you have there is, this is in the book of Daniel.
Right.
And this is the desolation that he spoke about. Mm-hmm. Read.
Let me read that again. Mm-hmm. But when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place.
Now he's telling you, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, you stand in the holy place. Mm-hmm. See? What do you mean? Well, hey, I can look at this chart. This is a Moses chart here. Mm-hmm. Now, this Moses chart, represents the greater and more perfect tabernacle, which is the universe. Mm-hmm. All right? And it's threefold, because we have Egypt, which is the court roundabout. Mm-hmm. We have the wilderness of Sinai, which represents the holy place. And we have Canaan land, which represents the most holy place. Mm-hmm. The river Jordan would be the veils, representing the veil dividing the two compartments, same as the Red Sea here, as a veil dividing this compartment from this one. Mm-hmm. So now, if I look on this chart, see, because remember, we're drawing back out of the law and the prophets, I can see the abomination of desolation. See, on here, Mark.
Mark 13, 14.
Mm-hmm.
But when ye shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing where it ought not.
Now, that's just a little variation. Now, see, the other one told you, now, when you see the abomination, you stand in the holy place.
Right.
This one says, when you see the abomination of desolation, standing where it ought not.
Yes.
Where is it ought not stand? Well, it's standing right here, because, see, I can look this golden
right.
calf. It's standing, that's the abomination of desolation
right.
back here. Standing where it ought not.
Right.
All right?
That's right.
Okay? Keep reading.
Let them that read it understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Then let them that be in Judea flee to the mountain.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's good enough. So now, I got two things here. One, it tells you, okay, stand in the holy place. Why? Because, see, here's the tabernacle. Because, see, in the holy place, you have light, mm-hmm. you have bread,
yeah.
and you have an intercessor.
Yeah.
Now, you can get for snick and elaborate all you want, but I like to just break it down to just hard, right. concise principles.
Yeah.
Light, bread, intercessor. That's about as simple as you can make that.
Yeah.
Okay? So now you stand in the holy place, and so therefore you are receiving the light. You're receiving the bread, and who is Yahshua? Which is the intercessor. All of this pointing to Yahshua. All right? Now, Luke.
Luke 21, 20. And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh.
Now, when you see Jerusalem compassed about by armies, then you know the desolation is nigh. See, now the other two scriptures say about the abomination of desolation.
That's
see,
right.
see, is that you know that, you know, when you see it, because if you see it, if it's within eyesight, it is nigh. Mm-hmm. It's right upon you. Okay, read.
21st verse.
Mm-hmm.
Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains,
mm-hmm.
and let them which are in the midst of it depart out.
Okay, in other words, see, if you're in the midst of it and you see now the only way you're going to see the abomination of desolation is that you have to be quickened or transmitted by the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
See? Otherwise, you ain't going to see anything. But once you've been translated and you see it, and I was telling you, flee to the mountain. What are you talking about? Go find a hill? No. Flee to the mountain. This is the mountain. See, this is the elevated state right here. Flee to the mountain. Read.
And let them which are in the midst of it depart out.
And let those that are in the midst depart out. John writes, come out of Babylon, my people, and be not partaker of her plagues. What plagues? Well, the same plagues that happened down here in Egypt. But that's what John's looking back on. See, everything is a repetition. See, if it's not that way, then see, you would lose your way, or you'd get lost, or you wouldn't find, you know, you just get messed up. And see, and Yahweh wouldn't be that great of a deity if he said, well, I'm going to be this way one time, and then come down the line and went, well, I'm changing up over here. You see? See, then you could have an excuse. You say, well, look, Yahweh, you said this, now you come, now what, how am I going to keep up with you on this, you know? But see, but since he says, I change not, see, then you have no excuse on not knowing him as he really is, and as he actually exists.
And let not them that are in the countries enter there into.
Continue.
For these be the days of vengeance,
mm-hmm.
that all things that are written may be fulfilled.
Mm-hmm.
But woe unto them that are with child, mm-hmm. and to them that give suck in those days.
In other words, see, if the Holy Spirit is being formed in you, you haven't been, you know, been converted yet. You know, see, that's what the devil does. See, one of the biggest things the devil does is this. He's into birth control. See, that's what happened out here in Egypt. See, he was killing all the boy babies. Now, he's into birth control. He doesn't want you to be born at all. Why? Because he's back up here in the garden. See, it was told up here in transgression. See, the man Adam was told, by the sweat of his brow you will work. The woman, see, you have pain in childbirth. And Paul elaborates saying you will be saved in childbirth. And Lucifer said, and for Lucifer, he's going to eat the dust of the earth. Now, Lucifer knows that the woman's going to be saved in childbirth. So he, from his point of view, said, well, all I got to do is just be, you know, just wait. And once it come out, just kill it. Or if not, you know, if I catch the woman that, you know, who's pregnant, maybe I can trip her, push her down some steps or something, you know, make a miscarriage, that kind of thing. All these things are spiritually applicable. Mm-hmm. See, somebody come tell you, hey, man, you know, I want you to stay home today and watch the football game with me. No, man, I got to go to class. No, you can stay home and watch football. See, they're trying to miscarriage you. And that's the thing that kind of got to me, because I didn't think I was going to be here, because I was coming up with a whole bunch of excuses. You know, like, well, I ain't got no money and stuff. And then my birthday comes, and I get a plane ticket for a birthday present. and I said, okay, well, I ain't got no time, because I just went on vacation back in August. I know my boss, she's a hard lady, and she had already said she ain't giving up no time for Thanksgiving. And so I said, well, she told me, well, go ask anybody. I said, okay. So I asked that. She said, well, is this during the Thanksgiving holiday? I said, no, actually, it's just the week before Thanksgiving. Oh, well, that's okay, then, go on. I said, okay, well, I'm in school. I go to school. And I'm supposed to be doing this project. I'm supposed to be at home doing this project. It's a hard project, too. And I may end up flunking this class. And I would say, well, you know, I don't want to leave this, and I don't want to flunk this class. And so the thing came to me and said, well, which is worse?
That's right.
Flunking that class or flunking this class? And after thinking about it, I said, you know, I think I'm going to go up in the Lansing. And I'm glad I did come. So keep reading.
For there shall be great distress in the land, mm-hmm. and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword,
mm-hmm.
and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, mm-hmm. until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled.
Now, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And a lot of theologians are trying to figure this out. I mean, you can read commentaries, you know, mm-hmm. of the yin-yang about what theologians think the times of the Gentiles is.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the thing is, it says, till the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Well, before you can figure out when they were fulfilled, you have to determine when did they begin.
Mm-hmm.
And why they began.
Right.
And what's the purpose of it?
Right.
What is the significance of it to me?
Right.
Okay? Now, as again, we have to go back and get some preliminaries. I'll start at the beginning here. Get Genesis 12:1. Since we have some some visiting folks here, that, you know, we could try to mix a little milk with the meat. I mean, we've done that, you know.
It's impossible.
That's the taste of natural, and it's good for us.
Genesis 12:1.
Mm-hmm.
Now Yahweh had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, into a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great. And thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed.
Now Abraham was given a promise. And this promise said all families of the earth would be blessed by this seed. Not seeds plural, but by that one seed. And see, now, Abraham, he was in a place called Ur of the Chaldees, which we call Babylonia, or today we call it Iraq. And see, he is technically the first Hebrew. Now, the word Hebrew means he that comes from across the river. Now, the river Abraham had to cross was the Euphrates River to come down here. I'm just looking at it geographically. To come down here into Canaan's land, okay? So now he's the first Hebrew, okay? And so he walked length and breadth of Canaan's land, but he never stepped foot on the promised land. Now, Genesis 15 and 12, okay? I'm just trying to expedite this so we can get to the points, but, you know, but we want to bring people up together. We don't want, you know, we don't want to leave nobody behind.
All right.
Go ahead.
This is Genesis 15 and 12. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. And lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance.
Okay, so now that seed that's going to bless all the families of the earth, and really there's only two families, that's Jew and Gentile. And this seed singular that's going to bless all the families of the earth has to go down here, see, and go through some suffering. But afterwards, they're going to come out with great substance, okay? In other words, it started off up here, and they come down, and then they're going to come back, which is a round trip, okay? Descending and ascending. All right, so now they're down here. 400 years. And look, and that 400 years started as soon as Yahweh said that to Abraham. See, as soon as Yahweh said it, bam, that's when the 400 years began. They, and you know, they were still Abraham's loins, but that bondage began right then and there. Alright? So at the end of 400 years, Yahweh did visit them. See? One Joshua, son of Nun. That's why he could come out here to Moses at the burning bush and said, look, I've seen the affliction. You know, what's going on down here in Egypt. See? And I am come down to deliver them.
Yeah.
Right? Which he did. 1 Corinthians 10 and 1. See, now that was at the end of 400 years. It was already talked about how Yahshua come in at the 4,000 years. That's see, he was a placeholder. The principle is the fourth. The previous speaker was born in the fourth day. About the appearance of the sun, moon, and stars. See, well, you got the sun appearing down here. The real sun. I know they in Egypt they worship the sun, you know, sun Ra, all that stuff. But see, but here's the real sun down here in Egypt, okay? Got it?
Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink. For they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was the Messiah.
Now that rock was the Messiah. Now look, when they came up out of Egypt, okay, this is the year they came up out of, all right? Now we use this. We say 1491 BBY, or before the birth of Yahshua, okay? Now another way you could write this, you could say 2513 A. That stands for Anno Mundi, which is Latin for year of the world. Right? Now look, these numbers are straight on. In other words, 2513 years from the man Adam to the Exodus is this amount. And then you have 1491 years before the birth of Yahshua. Well, when you add this together, it comes out to 4004. And see, it was already mentioned about the four-year era. And when you look in most reference books on Jesus Christ, it'll tell you his birthday is 4 BC, and I know there's no such thing as before Christ. Let's see, it's like saying that's before Elohim. Mm-hmm. Just for this analogy, 4 BC to 29 AD. Okay? Even in the era, Yahweh is going to be right. Because you know why? Because it's still 4,000 years from Adam to Yahshua. Okay? Now, also, they come out, we'll use this, 25:13 a.m. Now, they came out here, and they got to this mountain over here, right? Now, Moses is told to come up alone by himself, right, up into this cloud, and he's going to receive the things Yahweh's going to give him. So he went up with Joshua. Well, I know, he wasn't alone, but see, it was Joshua that invited him up. He's still going up alone by himself. And so he's up there, he's laying down, and so he's seeing the vision of the heavens and the earth for 7 solar days. In other words, it did not take 7 days for Yahweh to create creation. It just took Yahweh 7 days to show it to Moses, or to explain it to him in a simplistic detail. Okay? So now, prophetically speaking, see, a day is for a year, and a year is for a day. All right? So these 7 days become 7 years. All right? And so when you add that on to 25:13, that comes up with 25:20. As was gone over the other night, a very mystical number, a very special number. Okay? We have it right here on the pyramid. It's the Great Pyramid here. That's 25:20. So in other words, see, the Israelites came out at the end of this. Or in other words, they were away from bondage in 25:20. See? At the end of those years. Okay? Now, they're out here for 40 years. I'm just expediting the story so we can get to the points. Now, they're out here for 40 years. And look, there were 603,550 folks that came up out of Egypt. That generation died out there in the wilderness because of disobedience. And it was a new birth, see, that went over, all right? Now, that new birth consisted of 144,000. What are you talking about? Let's see, there was 12,000 from each tribe. In other words, there's 12 tribes. So 12,000 from each tribe. See, that was 144,000 of the new birth. Now, they didn't count it back here, but John on the Isle of Patmos, looking back on the thing, called the number out.
Right.
Okay, 144,000 that came over. And see, and look, people, you know, like Jehovah's Witnesses always say, well, only 144,000 is going to be saved because they look and read the Bible and say that, okay? But if you keep reading that scripture, it says, yeah, it was 144,000 that went over, but then there was a number that no man could count.
Right.
See? Now, that 144,000 represented the fighting force for these folks. And they did. They went up here. Joshua, the son of Nun, led them. And they fought 40 years for the conquest of kings. And at the end of 40 years, Joshua, the son of Nun, allotted out the lands to each of the 12 tribes. In other words, see, that land represented their inheritance. All right? The fulfillment of a promise given to Abraham. Okay? So now here, they got their inheritance, all right? So now, after the, I don't want to say death, but Joshua ain't dying. After Joshua leaves the scene, so to speak, all right, there was no king over there. You know, it was just the elders of each tribe, you know, they went to them, they ruled over the tribe. There was no king. And so therefore, once Joshua was off the scene, then they began to, you know, the mess up. Maybe we should read that. Joshua 1, I mean, not Joshua, the Judges. Judges, yeah. Look, read the Judges 1 and
there was up another generation.
Right.
Second chapter.
Okay.
All right, this is Judges, the second chapter.
Mm-hmm.
And an angel of Yahweh came upon Gilgad and to mock him and said, I made you to go up out of Egypt, and I brought you unto the land which I sweared unto your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. Mm-hmm. And thou shalt make no league with the inhabitants of this land. You shall throw down their altars, but ye have not obeyed my voice. Mm-hmm. Why have you done this?
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, but they shall be as thorns in your sides. And their gods shall be a snare unto you. And it shall come to pass, when the angel of Yahweh spake these words unto all the children of Israel, that the people lifted up their voice and wept, and they called out the name of the place Bochim, and they sacrificed there unto Yahweh.
That's good. Now, that's what Joshua, he told, now, see, now, at that point, see, Joshua had told it before he left and said, look, Don't make a league with these folks. Don't worship the idols. Don't, you know. And then after he's gone, then they just go on and mess up. Then he had to come up out the grave and tell the folks. I said, I did not tell y'all to do this. See? But now, they're going to be, you know, going through some trials. See, I mean, and it's going to happen. Because, see, we're going to get in a minute. It's in the law that it was going to happen that way. Okay?
Right.
Now, the period of the judges, I think it's Acts 13, about the 40 to 50 years. And he suffered their manners 450 years. I think it's Acts 13. I used to be a semi-biblical maniac, then I got old. Anyway, while somebody's getting that.
13 and 20?
Go back above that, the verse before that.
19th verse. And when he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan.
That's Joshua, son of Nun, up here. All right, go ahead.
He divided their land to them by lot.
In other words, he gave them their inheritance.
Right.
All right, go ahead.
And after that, he gave unto them judges about the space of 450 years.
Now, he gave them judges about the space of 450 years. And this is a thing that even theologians don't understand today. Because this is where they get the chronology messed up. Because they think it's 400 concurrent years.
Right.
See? So, yeah, consecutive. Thank you.
Right.
Consecutive years. See? But with the way our founder explained it, see, it's like this. See, there were 15 judges between Joshua and the first king of Israel, who was Saul. Right? The last judge is Samuel the prophet. Mm-hmm. Now, when you go, and I see the textbook, it's delineated quite well.
Yes.
And it tells you about the judges, about the 15 judges. When you add up the time periods that they judged Israel, mm-hmm. it will come out to about 339 years. And that, now they went into various servitudes, like the Philistines and so on and all that. And so now, when you add all of those things up, it comes out to 111 years. And that accounts for the 450 years that's talked about in the passage in Acts. See, it's a combination of both the judges and the servitudes. Okay? Now, mind you, I should put this up. There were six servitudes during that period.
Right.
All right? And they were servitudes in their own land. They didn't go anywhere. They were just, you know, people came in and just conquered them in their own land and put them under subjection until Yahweh raised up a judge, you know, like Gideon or Barak or Samson or Deborah, you know, to deliver them out. And they were okay for a minute. Then they would go right back into their idolatrous state and Yahweh said, okay, yeah. So another meeting, okay, it's time to punish again. See? And so that's what that is about. Now, it was brought out the other night about the history of Judah and Israel, the kingdoms, all right? Because you had three kings at first, all right? You had Saul, David, and Solomon of what they call the United Monarchy. Now, that's to say all the 12 tribes were under one head, okay? Now, after Solomon's demise and his son took over, see, he was like, you know, well, look, you know, my father, you know, he chastised you with whips, but I'm going to chastise you with scorpions. And see, and that just caused a revolt among the tribes. 10 of them bolted away, became the northern kingdom of Israel, see. And the other two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, stayed and collectively became the kingdom of Judah with two separate lineages and so forth. Now, the 10 tribes that became the kingdom of Judah, they got taken away in 721 by the Assyrians. By Sargon. And so he came down and took them away into captivity. And then that begins the so-called legendary stories of the 10 lost tribes of Israel. They ain't lost. Yahweh knows where they are. You know? Just because you don't know, you know, I mean, Yahweh don't know. See? Now that was then. Now, later on, about a little more than 100 years after that, we're going to get another, you know, deportation, okay? And that's going to be caused by Nebuchadnezzar. But before we get to that, I need to get some precursors. I need to get Deuteronomy, I think this is 28th chapter. Anyway, maybe around 49. Because you see, Yahweh, when he thundered down this law from Mount Sinai, see, most people don't know about the Ten Commandments, but I have you know, he gave them 613 ordinances, statutes, and judgments. All right? And you should sit down and read some of them sometime. Because, see, he had to fulfill it, each and every one of them. And see, and we, as we said, the types and shadows, it takes the natural to understand the spirit. Okay? Now, Yahweh had told him out here in the wilderness, he said, look, he thundered down that law, and the people down there said, well, look, Moses, you go up there and see what he does. Because, see, you know, because don't let him talk to us like that anymore. And look, all that Yahweh said, will we do. All right? But don't let him talk to him. In other words, he got married. Then he married him. See, Yahweh became, it's just like, you know, you get married, right? And then you take this man to be lawful wedded wife, you know, husband, and sickness, and then you said, you know, I did. You know, that's what happened here. So Yahweh was the husband. Okay? Now, Yahweh told him, and said, now look, if you break my law, this is what's going to happen to you. Read.
This is Deuteronomy 28:49. Mm-hmm. And Yahweh shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as an eagle flyeth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, a nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young. He shall eat the fruit of thy cattle and the fruit of thy land until thou be destroyed, which also shall not leave thee either corn, wine, or oil, or increase of thy kind, or flocks of thy sheep, until he hath destroyed thee.
All right, now see, now this isn't, look, they haven't even got off the roof of this yet. Yahweh is telling them point blank what's going to happen to you. Because he already knew, look, it's just like this. Yahweh foreknew Adam was going to sin him. That's why the salvation was already prepared in the day of eternity, before anything come forth. Because when Yahweh transmuted it to this state, that's a death. See? And then life coming after death. So Yahweh foreknew what Adam was going to do. Yahweh foreknew what Israel was going to do. And he told them in the law. He said, now, when you break this law, hey, I'm going to send an invasion force after you. Jump down to 63.
63rd verse. And it shall come to pass as Yahweh rejoice over you to do good and to multiply you, so shall Yahweh rejoice over you to destroy you.
Now, see, now, Dr. Kinley used to say this. I'll help you both ways.
Yeah.
You know, I'll help to save you, and I will help to destroy you. It's all right with me, because I'm going to take pleasure in either one. Ain't that what it's saying? Yahweh said, you know, I took great pleasure in saving you, but hey, by the same token, I will take great pleasure in destroying you. See, read.
And to bring you to naught, and ye shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it.
They said, you're going to be plucked off of this land. In other words, I will dispossess you. Right. Now, you know the way I look at that? It's just like, you know, some of us, you know, we buy a car, we go to the loan company, you know, and, you know, we make an agreement and say, okay, we pay X amount of dollars per month, all right? And you have a contract. See, the Israelites were under a contract. This covenant. See, this covenant here was a contract. That was a contract Yahweh made with them. So likewise, you have a contract with the loan company. You want to get a car. You know, you buy a car. And they say, okay, well, you know, you pay so much, X amount of dollars per month. Okay. And, you know, and it's all in writing. You may not read everything in the contract, but everything that's stipulated for your terms is written in that contract, including the part where it says, if you miss X amount of payments, we, the loan company, have a right to come back and repossess your car. Now, you may not have read it, but I assure you, it's in there in black and white. Likewise with this. See, this contract. Yahweh said, if you disobey my law, I have the right to send an invasion army against you. I, Yahweh, if you disobey this law, I, Yahweh, have a right to pluck you off of this land. Why? Because it's written in the contract. You see that? Okay. Now, Jeremiah 25:11. Because we said, hey, it's got to be established in the law. So we got to go to the prophet, because we saw we started off through the law and the prophets. And Jeremiah, he's just going to reflect this, or he's going to echo this.
Jeremiah 25:11. And this whole land shall be a desolation and astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years.
Okay, so now Jeremiah is making a prophecy that said these nations are going to serve the king of Babylon. Why 7 years? Why is he saying that? Because it's in the law. For him to even say that, he had to draw it out of the law. You see that? So now, that's what's going to happen to these Israelites, okay? Now, let me just digress for a moment and just show this 25-20. Because see, that's because 25-20 years is the time that Yahweh had determined for these Israels to be subject to the Gentiles. Mm-hmm. Now, see, we showed this 25-20 here, see, with Moses going up here, because it was 25-13 when he came up here, 7 days up here, right. 7 prophetic years, 25-20. Mm-hmm. All right? So that's 25-20 with Moses, or with Joshua, son of Nun. Because it was Joshua, son of Nun, that took Moses up here and then transfigured before him. And then showed and transfigured each day of the creation and then rested on the seventh day. All right? So now you got to see that being fulfilled by Yahshua Messiah. Matthew 17 and 1?
17. This is Matthew 17 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
And, and after 6 days, Yahshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart.
Now it says after 6 days. So it says 6 days had passed, and the day that they're going up is the seventh day.
That's right.
Okay? Read.
And was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah, talking with him.
Mm-hmm.
And answered Peter, and said unto Yahshua, mm-hmm. Master, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here 3 tabernacles.
Why? Because, see, that's what happened back here. Moses, see, because look, you got Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu back here, and it's 70 elders, see. Aaron is the elder, they have to buy your brothers. Here you got Peter, James, and John. This is the fulfillment of this.
Right.
So here's Peter here. He's the elder, James and John, the brothers. So now here's Peter talking about a tabernacle. Why? Because a tabernacle was mentioned back here.
Right.
See, one is instituted and the other is fulfilled. All right? Go ahead.
One for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Eliah.
Mm-hmm.
While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which mm-hmm. saith, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
Mm-hmm.
Hear ye him.
Mm-hmm.
And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were sore afraid.
Mm-hmm.
And when Yahshua came and touched them and said, arise, be not afraid.
Mm-hmm.
For when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Yahshua only.
Mm-hmm.
And when they and as they came down from the mountain, Yahshua charged them, saying,
mm-hmm.
tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again from the dead.
Now, for him to say that, I meant that I lived before, died before, resurrected before. See, that was Joshua's son. No, we read that in part back here. But the point I wanted to draw out of this passage was this. First, they had to go up the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Then they had to come down the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
That's a round trip.
Mm-hmm.
That's a circle. Mathematically speaking, that's 360 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on the seventh day that they went up there.
Mm-hmm.
So when you take 7 times 360,
mm-hmm.
that will equal out to 25-20.
That's right.
That's the fulfillment of that back there.
Mm-hmm.
You see, now there's other ways that I don't have the time to go through the other one, you guys, but perhaps in another day. But that's to show you that, see, Yahshua's fulfilling everything back in the scriptures. And also that number is a significant number because Yahweh's going to use this in a repetitious manner to judge Israel and to show us down here in the last days and time what it really means. Okay? Now, as we said earlier, there were 6 servitudes under the judges. There were 15 judges. Samuel was the last judge before the first kingdom. Alright? You got the kingdoms of Judah, kingdom of Israel. Kingdom of Israel was taken by Assyria in 721. So now we're coming down to the point where Judah is going to be dispossessed of their inheritance. I want Exodus 34, I think it's 5. Go ahead.
Exodus 34 and 5.
Mm-hmm. And I want.
Go ahead. And Yahweh descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh passed by before him and proclaimed, Yahweh Elohim, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth,
mm-hmm.
keeping mercy for thousands.
keep this in mind. Now, it was brought out that Solomon's temple was dedicated in the year 1000. Well, technically speaking, 1001. Now, this is the proof for that. See, we say that 1491 BBY is the date of the Exodus out of Egypt, all right? Daniel's 9:25, read that. This is 25 or 24, 70 was the years, that's what I want. 24, thank you.
Okay, this is Daniel, was it 9:24?
Uh-huh.
70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgressions and to make an end of sin and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy.
Okay, now 70 weeks a year is simply this. 70 times 7. Right? Which is 490. Alright, so now 490 years from the Exodus would bring you to 1001 BBY, which is the completion and dedication of Solomon's temple. Mm-hmm. Now, we just read the scripture in Exodus where it said that Yahweh was going to punish them unto the third and the fourth generation. Now, we learned in here that zeros are placeholders. You can detract from them, or you can add them on. So now, third and fourth generation, we'll just take the bigger number, fourth generation, and we'll just add some zeros onto it, and that would be 400 years from the dedication of Solomon's temple. And that would lead you to 601 BBY, which is the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. Why? Well, 2 Kings 24:1. Now, we could go like this, 1004, for example. And, you know, because this is when the temple was completed, but it hadn't been dedicated yet. All right? And you go 400 years from there, and that will get you to 604 BBY. Read 2 Kings.
2 Kings 24:1.
Uh-huh.
In the days of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his servant in 3 years.
In other words, see, Jehoiakim was the king of Judah, and Nebuchadnezzar came up and conquered him. Now, Nebuchadnezzar was trying to be nice to him, so they said, look, we'll let you stay on here. You can still be king in name, but you'll be a vassal. At the end of the year, we want our cut. We want our tribute, you know, gold, silver, linen, you know, girls, grain, you know, fruits, so forth. We want our cut at the end of the year. All right? But you can remain on. Okay? You can still be king of Israel, but you know who the real boss is. All right? So now, keep reading.
Then he turned and rebelled against him.
Okay, he rebelled against him after 3 years, and after 3 years of not getting his cut, you know, because even though he was a king, you know, he was getting, you know, before Nebuchadnezzar came, he was living high on the hog. But when Nebuchadnezzar come and, you know, say, well, I want my cut. See, he wasn't living so high after a while. After 3 years of that, he said, man, look, I'm getting sick of this, man. No, we ain't sending nothing this year. And Nebuchadnezzar said, oh, no, well, I'm going to have to come in here and punish you then. Right. All right? So now after 3 years, at the end of 3 years, that'd be 601 BBY. See, read.
And Yahweh sent against him bands of the Chaldees and bands of the Syrians and bands of the Moabites and the bands of the children of Ammon and sent them against Judah to destroy it. And according to the word of Yahweh, which he spake by the servants, the prophets.
Go ahead.
Okay. Surely at the commandments.
That's good enough. Get Daniel 1 and maybe around 2 or 3. Because see, now they were captives in their own land for 3 years. The beginning of 604, all right, then in 601, that's when the great deportation began. In fact, when you read the book of Kings in the 25th and 26th chapters, there were three of them. See, the first one was in 601. The second one was 597 BBY, and the last one was 586 or 585 BBY, and the last one, Nebuchadnezzar destroyed Solomon's temple, burned it to the ground. Took the articles with him, well, not all of them, too. He took the lampstand and the table of Jupiter. You know, if you ever read like Daniel about Belshazzar, about the handwriting on the wall. See, it says, see, he was having a party, and the light that he used, the light of the party, was the lampstand. And the food that was being served there was the table of shewbread. So he's sitting up in there having a party with his feet on the table of shewbread, and the big lampstand lighting the whole hall up, and then this handwriting on the wall comes happening, see, because he's up here violating Yahweh's precious vessels, you know. Daniel.
Daniel 1 and 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim,
The third year,
king of Judah, came And Yahweh gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand,
mm-hmm.
with part of the vessels of the house of Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his deity, and he brought the vessels into the treasures of the house of his deity.
Yes.
And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
of the king's seed, and of the princes.
Now, see, now they were bringing them. See, they were deporting them out of Israel, back to Babylon, especially of the king. In other words, they didn't want the low-grade folks. They wanted the artisans, the king's seed, you know, the higher, you know, the professionals and stuff, but the poor people, you know, couldn't, you know, you know, say, well, you guys, you know, you can hang around. We don't need you. But these folks we're taking. See, Daniel was one of them. Because he was of the king's seed. He was of the tribe of Judah.
Yes.
See? So he was taken, along with his fellows, back to Babylon, along with many others, all right? So now that that's the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. What do you mean? That means that these folks, and listen, we say the judges were sixth servitude. This represents the seventh and the last servitude,
yes.
that they would be in their own land.
Right.
Right. Right? So now they're plucked, because we read it in the scripture, I will pluck you off of this land.
Yeah.
That's what Yahweh did. He plucked them off of this land. He disinherited them.
Yeah.
All right? And so they were out here. You know, and look, they're subject to the times of the Gentiles for 2,520 years. Why? Because when did they come out of bondage here? After 2520. So see, Yahweh's got to repeat itself. See? All right? Now, Dr. Kinley wrote about this in the fourth volume of the textbook. And I've been reading this for years. And, you know, and I'm thinking, okay, this is some nice mathematical numbers. It seems okay. But what is it really talking about? And I never really understood it for years until maybe a little while back or so. Because Dr. Kinley said this about himself. He said he is the seventh angel.
Mm-hmm.
So he come down here at the end of this age to warn the people. Mm-hmm. All right? To blow the trumpet, so to speak. That's what the seventh angel does. He's got to sound the trumpet. He's got to warn. Yahweh's not going to destroy you without warning. He said, look, I'm going to destroy you. Here's a chance for you to get right. If you don't, hey, then I, Yahweh, have the right to destroy you. Just that simple. See, Dr. Kinley put it like this. Yahweh has given all of us a measure of intelligence to understand this doctrine.
Right.
If you choose not to use it, see, then Yahweh has a right to destroy you. See, he has a right to send you to the lake. See, it ain't Yahweh's fault you decided not to use it. See, he's given it to you. And see, and look, and that's why everybody can get up there and make some reasonable testimony of what Yahweh has shown them. Because he's given us, he's given this to all of us. Okay? Now, 2,520 years, all right, from the times, let me put it up. Times of the Gentiles. I'll say times. You know what I'm saying? Now, 2,520 years. See, from 601 BBY, would lead you to 1919 AD. All right, so now what's so significant about that? Well, look, Yahweh created Israel. He drew one man out, Abraham, and created a nation, right? Not that because they were anything great, anything spectacular. He did it because they were the least of all the families of the earth, but he used that to make an example for all the other families of the earth to look at to get an understanding on who he is.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, we understand this, that this was back here in the post-Diluvian age under the dispensation of the law. So now we're coming on down here, and now we are in a different age, and we're in a different dispensation. All right? Now, it does not negate the Jews, I'm talking about the natural Jews, as being an example. Because, you know, you have people in the world like, what's that guy over in Iran? Say, well, we're going to destroy the Jews. We're going to wipe them off the face of the earth. If I were him, I wouldn't try it. Because Yahweh don't play that. Even though, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, he'll mess with the Jews. He'll do whatever he wants with the Jews, but don't you touch them.
Right.
Not if they're fulfilling my purpose. And they are. They are fulfilling his purpose. So now, you know, you're not going to have some idiot or as Dr. Kinley would say, some ignorant silly ass to come along and change something. Oh, that's an election. I can show it to you. To come along and change something that Yahweh just set up. Okay? Now, 2520 years at the end of 601, that's 1919. So now, what's going on here? Let's just take, we said it takes the natural to understand the spiritual. So now, I want you to read this. This is a letter that was given to Lord Rothschild in 1917 by a man named A.J. Balfour, who was the head of the Foreign Department of the British Empire. And this is what he had to say.
which has been submitted to and approved by the cabinet.
Mm-hmm.
His Majesty's government views with favor the establishment of Palestine in Palestine as a national home for the Jewish people,
mm-hmm.
and will use their best endeavors to facilitate the achievements of this object. It being clearly understood that nothing shall be done which shall prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine,
mm-hmm.
or the rights or political status enjoyed by Jews in any other country.
Mm-hmm.
I should be grateful if you would bring this declaration to the knowledge of the Zion of the Zionist Federation. Yours sincerely, author James Balfour.
Okay. Now at that time the British Empire, for the most part, ruled the world.
Right.
So I had colonies on every continent.
Yeah.
In fact, one of the old sayings of the British Empire is the sun never sets on the British Empire. Because they had colonies on every continent.
That's right.
All right, so now this is like them heading toward the downward spiral of their empire. Okay? But toward the end of it, they say, well, look, the Jews have a right. Now, why would they do that? All of a sudden, the Jews have a right to have a homeland. And this was in 1917, 2 years before the end of 2520. You see that now? See, that Yahweh's working his work here, okay? Now, I think it's Daniel 9:26.
Shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself.
Mm-hmm.
And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood.
Go above. Make 25 is what I want.
Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times.
Go ahead.
And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself.
Mm-hmm.
And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city
mm-hmm.
and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood.
Mm-hmm.
And unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week.
Ah, he shall confirm the covenant with many. For 1 week now, mm-hmm. 1 week is how long?
Okay.
Prophetically speaking, seven days is 7 years. All right? So that would bring you to 1926. Now, the reason why I said that, because this is in the textbook, and I never understood until I started doing some research why Dr. Kinley even put it in there like that, because he's using the calculations. And so now, you know, the end of the Gentile, the times of the Gentile, the end of the time of the Gentiles for the Jews is 25, 20 years. But he's going to, you know, but the covenant has to be confirmed for 7 years. I'm like, wait a minute. What covenant is he talking about?
Oh.
You know? And I never understood that until I do some research, which is what we're supposed to do.
Right.
This is the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research, right?
Right.
So, here we go. Now, she's going to read this about the covenant being confirmed. Now, this is from the League of Nations. And if you know anything about history, the League of Nations was a precursor to the United Nations.
Right.
Right? Then they became defunct. But they did do some notable political things before they became defunct. This is one of them. Read.
All right. This is coming from, this is Palestine Mandate.
This is called a Palestine Mandate. In other words, the League of Nations issued a Palestine Mandate. Read.
In June 1922.
In June 1922. See, in other words, we got 7 years from 1919 to 1926. 1922 would fall right in within the 7 year covenant period. Right in the midst of it, 1922. Go ahead.
The League of Nations passed the Palestine Mandate. The Palestine Mandate was an explicit document regarding British responsibilities and powers of administration in Palestine, including securing the establishment of the Jewish national home and safeguarding the civil and religious rights of all the inhabitants
mm-hmm.
of Palestine. This document defining the British obligations as mandate power copied in the text of the Balfour Declaration
mm-hmm.
concerning the establishment of the Jewish homeland. His Majesty's government views with favor the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people
mm-hmm.
and will use their best endeavors to facilitate the achievement of this object.
Mm-hmm.
It's being clearly understood that nothing shall be done which shall prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine or the rights of the political status enjoyed by Jews in any other country. Many articles of this document specify actions in support of Jewish immigration and political status. However, it was also stated that in the large, mostly Arab territory in the east of the Jordan River, called Transjordan, Britain shall postpone or withhold application of the provisions dealing with the Jewish national home.
Okay, that's good enough because that can get along. But the point is, the League of Nations made a Palestine mandate to confirm what had been written in 1917 of the Balfour Declaration. See, that's the covenant being confirmed. And look, this is a picture here. This is a picture of some Hebrews going back to Palestine in the 1930s. Okay? See, they're on the land. And because why? Because it's at the end of 2520. And so Yahweh has allowed them to go back. All right? And pass it around. And this is a flag. I got this. This is a flag. This is the flag of the Palestinian mandate. He's got the Union Jack of the British Empire in the circle representing Palestine. Because they ruled it from 1927 to 1948, which is the beginning of the country of Israel. Okay? Now, also I have something here. This is a stamp that was issued from Palestine in 1927, and it's postmarked. And if you look on the bottom of it, it has Hebrew and Arabic. See, meaning that there's a presence of both of them there in Palestine at this time. In other words, the Jews are coming home. They're coming back to their inheritance at the end of 2520 years. See that? Alright? I'm gonna get to the spiritual reality in a minute. Now, 5 years from 1926, I need some more room up here. Now, Dr. Kinley, if you ever read that section, he stops in 1926. It isn't going any further than that. And I used to wonder why don't you, because it was just a simple measure of 1926 plus 5. Alright, he could have just as easily wrote that in a sentence. But see, the thing I realized after listening to some of the lectures, he said this. I can't toot my own horn. You're gonna have to do that. Right. So now I'm tooting this horn. Because see, 5 years from 1926 is 1931. Yeah. Why 5 years? Well, hey, when Joshua the son of Nun appeared down in Egypt, he appeared down here 10 years after Moses left. Moses was 40 years old when he left, and Joshua appeared 10 years afterwards. So that would make Moses 50 years old when Joshua appears down here in Egypt. See, we said Z was a placeholder, you know, to be added or subtracted. Another thing is this. This age began with the day of Pentecost. What's the word Pentecost mean? It means 50. See, so it started off that way with a 50 or a principle of 5. It's got to end that way. Talking about this divine vision. See, and look, this divine vision is the end of the times of the Gentiles being fulfilled. What do you mean, 1931? No, the vision itself. Because you didn't come in here in 1931. You came in whenever you came in. Right. But when you realized and you understood it and it was translated in your heart, right. Romans 2, 28.
He is not a Jew.
See, you ain't a Jew no more. You're a Gentile no more. He's not a Jew.
Which is one outwardly.
He's not a Jew. You're not a Jew outwardly. That's what I'm trying to say. See, because I'm looking around the room, I see white folks, I see black folks, I see Asians, I see Latinos. You ain't a Jew outwardly.
There you go.
Not apparently so. But inwardly, read.
Neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh.
See, we ain't asking you to get circumcised in the flesh. We're asking you to have your heart circumcised. Because it's an inward operation.
Right.
Go ahead.
But he is a Jew, which is one inward.
Mm-hmm.
And the circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of Yahweh.
In other words, if you come here and sit down and you eat this vision and you let it translate you into the kingdom, and as they say, you have these veils ripped off of you, you, in other words, your time as a Gentile has been fulfilled. Because you're a spiritual Jew now. Get it? See? 2520 has translated you into a Jew. See, and now, see, that's what it really means. Because people look around, well, the day 1960, was that time? That ain't what it's talking about. Because, see, look, back here, yeah, it was chronological, but see, we crossed an age.
Right.
We crossed a dispensation.
Yes.
So it has to be applied spiritually. What are you talking about? Because at the end of 2520, the Jews got their inheritance back.
Right.
Look, up here in the garden, the scripture says this, and Adam all died.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam all been alive. But before you died in Adam, you lived in Adam. Because he was up here in the garden with no transgression happening. See, he had it. He was created outside of the garden and put into the garden. That was the meaning. He was given an inheritance. Then he lost that inheritance. Yeah. Now here's Joshua the Messiah coming along, getting that inheritance back. Here you are, man. In Adam, you lost that inheritance. But now, in the end of this age, you got that inheritance back. See? And your time as a Gentile has been fulfilled. In other words, it is brought to an end. See? That's what it's talking about. And look, let me tell you, and see, look, just like, and see, that's what happened to the Israelites. They got their land back. See, the country of Israel got established, and see, and that's it. And they will be there until the very end. Why? Because you translated into the kingdom. You will be there until the very end. See, and look, and oh my gosh. See, look, see, when Dr. Kelly comes on the scene, man, look, you got some fascist folks out there, you know, like Adolf Hitler, all right? See, he started his reign of terror in 1930. He became Chancellor of Germany in 1933. And then he ruled from to 1945. That's 12 years. And for those 12 years, he persecuted the Jews. See, that's like saying the 12 tribes, okay? Now look, now why is he doing that? Well, look, here's Satan down here. See, he's bruised in the head. That's why he's got the mark 666. And he doesn't understand anything. His whole thing is carnal. He's looking at it physically, looking at it fleshly, literally, see? And so therefore, just like back here, he's looking for the Messiah back here. But he pulled a trick on it. Joshua and the son of Nun appeared down here instead of coming through the loins of a woman. See, but Pharaoh's out here killing all the boy babies. Two and under, correct? Killing two and under. Joshua's fulfilling that. He had to come through the loins of a woman because he's got to fulfill what was told to Eve. She would be saved inside childbearing. But he avoided Herod's purge. And Herod had to kill all those babies in Bethlehem. Two and under, correct? Here's Dr. Kennedy. He's getting a vision down here. Hitler, with that satanic mind, he's looking for the Jews, natural and physical. But the age has changed. The dispensation's changed. It's a spiritual Jew now. He's killing Dr. Kelly. He's got the vision 1931. Can't you see he's trying to kill the Jews too? It ain't no different. It's got to be a repetition. If it ain't that way, then we need to go home and get out of here. This is just a bunch of honka. And he is the seventh angel. I got time for that. I only have 5 minutes. Give me Daniel 7:25, King James, Holy Name 5:25, I think. Quickly.
Daniel 7:25. And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the sons of the Most High, and think to change the times and laws, and shall be given into his hand. To a time, times, and dividing of time.
Times, times, and the dividing of time. Now, what's a time? See, time is one of the old English expressions. It means a year. Okay? Now, in Yahweh's timetable, a year, prophetically speaking, is 360 days. 12 months of the year, 30 days in a prophetic month. 12 times 30, 360 days. All right? So that's what a time is. 360 days. All right? Now, I don't have to leave it like that. I can elaborate if I want to. I can say, hey, this is 12 months. The same as 12 months.
Right, that's right.
I can even go and say, just simply, 1 year. Times, because it's plural. Right. Just two times whatever it is up here.
Right.
Two times 360 is 720 days.
That's right.
Right. Two times 12 months, 24 months.
Yep.
Two times 1 year, 2 years.
Right.
Dividing a time, or half a time, it's just half what it is up here.
Right.
All right. 180 days. All right. 6 months. One half year. Alright? Now this is a matter of simple addition here. Because you got what? You got 1260 days here. Alright? You got 42 months. Alright? And you got 3.5 years. Alright? It's all the same thing. See, it's all the same thing. I should make this analogy. Like, if I borrow $20 from you, you give me a $20 bill, I come back. If I give you 2 tens, would that be all right?
Yeah.
If I give you 21s, would that be all right?
Yeah.
How about 4 fives? Why? Because it's the same thing. Okay, quickly, Daniel, the 12th chapter, last chapter of the day. Is it 12th chapter? Maybe around, what did you say, 11? Okay, somewhere around there. Yeah, that's what I want.
Okay, this is going to be...
When the daily sacrifice is taken away. Where you at?
Okay, we're going to start with Daniel 12 and 11.
All right.
And from the time that the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the abomination that maketh desolate set up, there shall be 1,290 days.
1,290 days. Why? Well, see, we just showed the graph up here. See, 1,290 days is no more than 1,260 plus 30. That's 1,290 days. That says the daily sacrifice is taken away. What do you mean? We showed you 1,260 is the same as 3.5 years. All right? Plus 30. That would be 33 and a half years. Mm-hmm. In principle, see, in principle, 1290 and 33 are the same thing in principle, because 33 and a half years of Yahshua's life after his death, burial, resurrection, that's when the daily sacrifice was taken away, right? Because he was the sacrifice of sacrifices. Okay? Read.
Blessed is he that waiteth and cometh to the 1,305 and 30 days.
1,335 days. What are you talking about? Look, we sold you back here. See, Daniel's back here. He's in the post-Diluvian age back here under the dispensational law. He's in a vision, because it was talked about. He's in eternity. And see, an eternity is not a state of continued time. It's a state of endlessness. Because, see, time begins and ends within eternity.
Right. Mm-hmm.
See, and so now he's up in here talking about Daniel. And he's looking at the thing, because he was already mentioned that Daniel saw things.
Right.
You know, he wasn't allowed to say or mention, which means that he's looking back at the thing. He's looking all the way forward at the thing. And he's looking down forward. He's coming down and he says, oh, well, at 1,290 days, well, the daily sacrifice is going to be taken away.
Uh-huh.
But now he's looking past the cross.
Right.
And said, well, blessed is he who waited until the 1335.
Yeah. Right.
Why? Because when he begins to sound his trumpet,
right,
the word of Yahweh, the purpose
that's
of Yahweh,
right,
would be about finished. Be about finished.
Right.
Be about finished.
Yeah.
Why? What do you mean? Hey, see, 1,290 days minus 1335. See, that gives you 45 years. What are you talking about? How long did our founder preach? 45 years. Why? He is, see, Daniel, oh, quickly. The seventh day, oh, quickly, Revelations, quickly. Because John is looking back on this thing.
Yes.
Look, not only is he confirming Moses, he's confirming all the prophets. Why? Because all the prophets are preaching the things that Moses wrote in the law.
Yes.
So he's got to confirm them all.
Yes.
So when John is, go ahead, quickly, because I'm out of time.
This is Revelations 10 and 7. And then the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound.
When he begin to sound, read.
The mystery of Yahweh should be finished.
It should be finished. Why is John saying that? Because he's looking back. And he sees Daniel back there.
Yes.
And Daniel talking about the 1290, the 1335. See, look. Dr. Kinley said this, and this is, I hear people say this all the time. Well, you know, I understand what Moses wrote, but I don't quite understand what John is writing.
Mm.
Well, let me tell you something. That simply means you don't understand the whole thing. Because John is confirming Moses.
Right.
See, now if you don't understand how John is confirming Moses, then you really don't know Moses.
Right.
That's just the plain fact of it, see? Because, if you don't understand these two, then you sure ain't going to understand what Dr. Kinley's saying. Because his vision encompasses the whole thing.
Right.
See? And he is that seventh angel.
Right.
He is, I mean, he's the one that, I mean, and look, and I know people are trying to worship him and all that, you know, and that's something he never wanted. Because
right.
He said, that ain't my job to be worshiped. I didn't come here to die for you. That was already done. That was already. I'm just here to blow the horn and let you know what's up.
That's right.
See, but you're going to sit up here, but I'll tell you something. You sit up here and go around talking about, well, I'm saying the name of Dr. Kinley, all you're going to do is just going to die.
And
you're going to fail.
Right.
And you're going to fail miserably.
Right.
All right? Until you come, you know, and look, it's just best. You know, and I think I'm done. I know I'm done. The time is up. I say this to my folks at home. If we would just simply follow the breadcrumbs that our founder left, you know what I said? Just the breadcrumbs.
Right.
It would lead us to the most profound things in the universe.
Yes.
Simply explained. Because
yes.
There's no such thing as deep. The only thing something is deep to you is because it hasn't been explained to you yet. But once it's explained to you in its utter simplicity, it remains deep no more. Why? Because now it's translated into you. You have become a son. You have become part of it, see? That's why Yahweh wrote there in Isaiah, he said, look, my thoughts are not your thoughts and your ways are not my ways. Why? Because he said that I was under the law.
Mm-hmm.
It was impossible for his thoughts to be your thoughts. Because you weren't filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, on this side, the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit is in you. You translate into the kingdom. Now, his thoughts are now your thoughts. His ways are now your ways. You understand what I'm saying? And that's all we want to say to you. And look, maybe one more scripture, and I'll be done. I promise. Romans, because I got to say it, because this is a lesson I learned. Romans 12, quickly. 14, because I'm out of time, so I'll use this.
This is Romans 12 and 14. Bless them that persecute you.
Well, bless them that persecute you. And I know I used to be real good, because folks used to come here talking some yin yang. I'd get up behind them. I'd ring them. I got it on videotape. Believe me. I ringed this guy so bad once that he went to the board of trustees and complained about it. And they put it in their minutes. They said, well, you people in Ontario need to treat folks a little bit. I said, well, when they start preaching the truth, we will. But then I had to think, because I ran across this scripture. Quickly read. Okay, and this is a lesson I'm trying to learn here.
Bless them that persecute you.
Mm-hmm.
Bless and curse not.
Read.
Rejoice with them that do rejoice.
Read.
Weep with them that weep.
Uh-huh.
Be of same mind one towards another. Mind not high things,
mm-hmm.
but condescend to men of low estate.
Mm-hmm.
Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense to no man evil for evil.
No, you don't fight fire with fire. You fight fire with water.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you put it out. You add fire and stuff, you're just going to make it even bigger and worse. See, read.
Provide things honest in the sight of all men.
Read.
If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men.
Mm-hmm.
Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves,
mm-hmm.
but rather give place unto wrath.
Mm-hmm.
For it is written, vengeance is mine, and I will repay, saith the other.
That's what I had to learn, because I thought I had to get up on the floor behind somebody and get vengeance. See, no, all I got to do is preach the truth. That's enough to say. I ain't got to bag on nobody. I ain't got to beat on nobody. I ain't got to do none of that. I ain't got to say, oh, you a liar, you wrong. I ain't got to do none of that damn stuff. All I got to do is preach the pattern. That's more than enough. Please.
Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him.
I'm going to feed you. Even though you don't compete with me, I'm going to still feed you.
If he thirst, give him drink.
I'm going to give you something to drink. Not some poison water, but some good stuff. Feed.
For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head.
What coals of fire are you talking about? Wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. That's the only thing that's going to purge somebody of the idiot nonsense that's going on. The only way. Sitting up trying to beat somebody up, beat it out of them, that ain't going to happen. You got to preach the truth to them. Read quickly.
Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good.
That says overcome evil with good. That is what preach the truth.
Yeah.
I see it all the time, because I look in their faces when I'm on the front, and certain things I'm sitting up talking about, I know they don't understand it, because I can see in their face. I say, well, you know, instead of sitting up there beating somebody on the head, here's a drink of water. Show you something.
Mm-hmm.
Show you some real stuff.
Yeah.
Show you some real food.
Yeah.
Right? Here's some nourishment. And I'll let Yahweh do the rest.
Yeah.
That's all you can do.
Right.
I ain't gonna try. That's the lesson I had to learn. The lesson for you.
Yeah.
And I got it on video. Hey, I'm savage. Some folks believe it. Believe it. I can do it too. People know me well enough. I'll get you. But then I had to realize it. Now is that Jermaine the Savage? Is that, how is that really helping somebody? You know, you gotta preach the truth. You gotta tell it to them.
Yeah.
Gotta explain it to them.
Yeah.
And let Yahweh do the thing for them.
Yeah.
Thank you much.
Hallelujah.